Well, nice to see you all. Thank you for being here. I see neighbors that I haven't seen, even though they live just over the hill there. It's all very strange. I'd like to say a little bit about the song that I'd like to do. In 1970, Otto Preminger directed and produced a movie starring Liza Minnelli, and the movie was called Tell Me That You Love Me, Junie Moon. It was not a very successful movie, as movies go, but it had some nice features about it, and I'll tell you a little bit about it. It tells the story of three young adults, Liza Minnelli and two young men, who have lived most of their lives in a protected community. They're all struggling with their own individual challenges, both physical and emotional. And they decide, in the movie, they decide to branch out on their own. They rent an old house and they're gonna live independently and they can be strong and capable. And it's about the story of their commitment to doing that. And oddly enough, Preminger asked Pete Seeger to write the title tune for the song. And I have no idea why, except I would like to imagine that he noted that Pete Seeger was well aware of what it was like to struggle, what it was like for people who struggled, that he was compassionate and thoughtful and caring, and that he knew the value of community in terms of singing and being together, because this is really a movie about community. The song is called Old Devil Time, and it feels to me in some ways that it's fitting because it is about singing together and facing the challenges that we all face right now. We all have fears, except right now maybe they're a little more pronounced than they usually are, or we all have senses of loneliness, and maybe that's a little more pronounced right now. So it feels to me in some ways like it's a very fitting song for today. And the song is by Pete Seeger, and it's called Old Devil Time. Old Devil Time, you're gonna bring me down. Old Devil Time, you'd like to bring me cold. But when I'm afraid, my lovers gather round and help me rise to fight you one more time. Old Devil Pain, you thought you'd pin me down. You thought I'd die and beg you for the end. But at that very time, my lovers gather round and help me rise to fight you one more time. Old Devil Fear, you with your icy hands, Old Devil Fear, you'd like to freeze me cold. But when I'm afraid, my lovers gather round and help me rise to fight you one more time. Old Devil Hate, I knew you long ago before I learned the poison in your breath. Now when I hear your lies, my lovers gather round and help me rise to fight you one more time. No storm nor fire can ever beat us down. No wind that blows but carries us further on. And you who fear, all lovers gather round and we will rise to sing this one more time. And you who fear, all lovers gather round and we will rise to sing this one more time. Thank you.
I want to tell you first, before we start the program, I'm very grateful to be here to talk about Ella Sheppard and the Fisk Jubilee Singers. It was a project that I came upon in 1987, when I was asked to give a paper at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. And on the second day of the conference, one of the librarians at the Music Division of the Library of Congress took me aside and said, let's skip out of here this afternoon and go to see Fisk University. I knew nothing about Fisk University, but we walked literally across the tracks, kept going to this beautiful, beautiful campus. As we walked onto the campus, we heard this beautiful sound coming out of the chapel. And Wayne turned to me and says, that's the Jubilee Singers. And so I said, oh, because I really wanted to go to the library to see if I could find some Gershwin manuscripts that were supposedly there. And Wayne Shirley had come to Fisk University to see Ella Sheppard's diaries. She was the first accompanist. She was the organist. She was the person who arranged all the music. She was the person who coached all the singers. She was really the heart of the Fisk Jubilee Singers. And the afternoon was spent with Wayne. I would show him a Gershwin score and he would show me a quote from the Ella Sheppard's diaries. And after a while, I threw away the Gershwin and just went over to the diaries because they were so absorbing. They just were incredible. Here was this woman at the age of 20, traveling across the country, eventually to Europe. She met Queen Victoria, and she wrote it all down, these diaries. 5 years later, I went back to Fisk University to see the diaries again. And when I went in this time, there was a new librarian. Her name was Beth Howes. And as we talked more, she told me that she was the great-granddaughter of Ella Sheppard. So I was getting a very personal approach to Ella. So 33 years later, I'm finally being able to speak about Fisk Jubilee Singers and their sacred songs. The spirituals of the slaves were passed along generation to generation by mouth. None of these songs were written down. We don't know the musicians, we don't know the poets. We just know that they wrote over 6,000 songs about their anguish, about their joys. We hear the lullabies they sang for their children. So it's taken all of this time to bring the Jubilee Singers from my heart to yours. So you're not going to hear a half hour PowerPoint presentation that I filmed 2 days ago. And I would like you to check out the volume control of your computers because the volume of each song is a little different. My voice might sound the same, but all the music will be different. I also want to tell you that we have 5, maybe 6 senses in our bodies. And the first to be fully developed is the sense of hearing. 124 days after conception, the embryo can actually hear everything. In fact, it sort of grows the other senses. So if you're deprived of one sense, the others become more acute. So I often play the piano with my eyes closed. And when I listen to music, it's almost always with my eyes closed. So it's a little bit more precise. It comes into your hearts a little bit more clearly. So you're going to see pictures on your screen sometimes for 2 minutes, and you can just close your eyes and hear the music of the Fisk Jubilee Singers. I'll see you in a half hour.
With nothing but their voices, a group of former slaves changed the history of world music. Their story begins with Ella Sheppard. Ella Sheppard was born a slave in 1851 on Andrew Jackson's plantation in Nashville, Tennessee. She could expect a life of hard labor, serving the people who owned the land. Instead, she became a teacher, musician, and an international celebrity. Her father, Simon Sheppard, eventually earned enough money managing a livery stable in town to buy his daughter's freedom. His wife, Sarah, however, became her mistress's favorite house slave and could not be purchased. So Simon and Ella moved to Ohio, where she received an excellent education while learning to sing and play the piano. When the Civil War ended, she moved back to Tennessee to attend the Fisk Freed Colored School, eventually named Fisk University. She became its brightest star. A Union soldier who fought at Gettysburg, George White was invited by the American Missionary Association in 1865 to be the treasurer and penmanship teacher at the university. an avid music lover and amateur composer, he formed a choir of students and named them the Jubilee Singers. After a dismal beginning, the Jubilee Singers succeeded because they sang their sacred and secret songs, their slave songs. Ella Sheppard wrote in her diary, "The songs were associated with slavery and the dark past and represented the things to be forgotten. They were sacred to our parents, and we did not dream of ever using them in public. It was only after many months that gradually our hearts were opened to the wonderful beauty and power of our songs. We now call their slave songs spirituals. One of the over 6,000 spirituals on file in the library at Fisk University is one of my favorites, There Is a Balm in Gilead." My seventh grade American history teacher began our first class with Christopher Columbus in 1492 and moved directly to 1620 when 102 pilgrims disembarked from the Mayflower in Plymouth Harbor. But she didn't tell us that the previous year, the White Lion, a privateer, had landed near Jamestown with 25 enslaved Africans from Angola, who were quickly sold to colonists. Eventually, 12 million slaves were stolen from their African homes, and 350,000 were brought to the United States. In 1807, Thomas Jefferson, an owner of more than 600 slaves himself, abolished the slave trade. When the Civil War began in 1861, 4 million slaves were imprisoned in the United States, more than 10% of the population. Amongst the 400,000 American slave owners were the first 12 presidents of the United States, save John Adams and his son. It took 2 to 3 months to sail from the African coast to North America. Entombed in the bowels of the ships were people chained to the stacked pallets. I cannot imagine their suffering, but Odette could. She sings, "Sometimes I feel like a motherless child." When they arrived in eastern ports, the slaves were auctioned off and transported to farms and plantations throughout the South. They worked, were beaten, raped, abused, and tortured, but their voices were still their own. They sang when they worked in the fields.
I'll be so glad when the sun goes down.
When the sun goes down.
And they sang to communicate with their friends. As late as 1800, most slaves in the United States had not been converted to Christianity. In the years that followed, however, a flood of evangelical Christians were emphasized individual freedom and direct communication with God, brought about the first large-scale conversion of enslaved men and women. Some slaves were allowed to attend church services where they learned Christian doctrine, Bible stories, and European hymns. But they also attended camp meetings where they could share their sorrows and hopes. These camp meetings were among the rare occasions during which slaves could actually experience a feeling of freedom for at least a little while through singing, playing instruments, and sharing stories. Oh, freedom.
Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom over me. And before I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord and be free. Everybody.
Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom.
Sing it, sister.
In the late 1700s, the Underground Railroad grew steadily until the Civil War began. An estimated 100,000 slaves had escaped before the war had ended. Some of the spirituals used by the railroad had encoded lyrics. The Promised Land was Canada. The drinking gourd was the Big Dipper star formation, which points to Polaris, the pole star, to take the north to freedom. The River Jordan was the Ohio River, and Moses was a wrestler like Harriet Tubman. A former slave, she escaped in 1849 and then returned to the South 18 times to lead everyone, 300 people, to freedom. Tubman said that she used spirituals to signal slaves that she was in the area and would help any who wanted to escape. They would travel quickly by land but enter the water to hide their trails. States began in 1861 after decades of simmering tensions between northern and southern states over slavery, states' rights, and westward expansion. The election of Abraham Lincoln in 1860 caused seven southern states to secede and form the Confederate States of America. Four more states soon joined them. The war between the states ended with the Confederate surrender in 1865. The conflict was the costliest and deadliest war ever fought on American soil, with some 750,000 soldiers killed, millions more injured, and much of the South left in ruin. Among the dead were 36,000 black men and women. A turbulent era followed the Civil War with an effort to reintegrate Southern states from the Confederacy and incorporate 4 million newly freed slaves into American society. With the Reconstruction Act of 1867, newly enfranchised blacks gained a voice in government for the first time in American history, winning elections to Southern state legislatures and even to the United States Congress. A decade later, however, reactionary forces, including the Ku Klux Klan, would reverse the changes wrought by radical Reconstruction in a violent backlash that restored white supremacy in the South. In the antebellum South, African Americans were generally prevented from receiving education. During the Civil War, African Americans and Northern missionaries established schools in Union-occupied territories. After Appomattox, freed slaves, adults, and children alike flocked to newly found schools.
The gospel train is coming, I hear it just ahead. I hear the cowbells moving and rumbling through the land.
Get on board, children, get on board, children, get on board, children. For the true for me, a boy, get on board, children, get on board, children, get on board, children.
She's nearing now the station. Oh, sinner, don't be vain. But come and get your ticket and be ready for the train.
Get on board, children, get on board, children, get on board, children. For the sun for me, I'm on board, get on board, children, get on board, children, get on board, children. For the sun for me, I'm on board.
The fare is cheap and all can go, the rich and poor are there. No second class aboard this train, no difference in the fare.
Get on board, children, get on board, children, get on board,
Wilton Fisk, a former Union general, gave $30,000 to the American Missionary Association, a donation which included the abandoned barracks of a Union Army hospital. Here, Ella Sheppard was hired as the assistant choir master, becoming the first African-American professor at the college. Facing bankruptcy in 1871, Fisk University gave their last $40 to Fike, who assembled 9 students into a touring chorus. All but 2 of them were former slaves. Naming them the Jubilee Singers, they traveled the old Underground Railroad for 8 months, singing for American audiences, and they returned home with their goal, $20,000 to purchase the land for their school. Their debut concert was in Cincinnati, beginning the tour with traditional choral music of the day. Civil War songs, patriotic songs, classical music, including cantatas by Bach, Handel, and Mozart, operatic music, and American folk songs, some written by Stephen Foster. Night after night, the crowds loved their singing, but the collection of plates were needed. Ella wrote, "Many a time our audiences in large halls were discouragingly slim. Our strength was failing under the ill treatment at hotels and on railroads, poorly attended concerts, and ridicule. Seeing Mr. White among us, word soon traveled that he was a Yankee nigger school teacher." In November, they arrived at Oberlin College, the first integrated college in this country, where they sang for a national convention of ministers. At Oberlin, they added a new song to their concert repertoire, "Steal Away." Tour extended, continued perseverance and beautiful voices began to change attitudes among the predominantly white audiences. Eventually, skepticism was replaced by standing ovations and critical praise in reviews. Their sacred spirituals became the oldest of American folk songs, enthralling everyone who listened. In the audience of that convention of ministers was Henry Ward Beecher, a Congregationalist clergyman, social reformer, abolitionist, and the brother of Herrick Beecher Stowe, author of Uncle Tom's Cabin. "I shall never forget the rich tones of young men and women as they mingled their voices in a melody so beautiful and touching that I scarcely knew whether I was in body or out of body." Stowe told every member of the congregation to take out a $5 bill and leave it at the door as they exited. The Jubilee Singers paid off the $15,000 debt for Fisk University before leaving New York City. In Connecticut, they filled every hall and church and were earning more than $1,200 each week. Mark Twain lived in Hartford and became an avid fan for the rest of his life. "I do not know when anything has so moved me as did the plaintive melodies of the Jubilee Singers. It was the first time for 25 or 30 years that I had heard such songs or heard them sung in the genuine old way. And it is a way, I think, that white people cannot imitate and never can for that matter. For one must have been a slave himself in order to feel what the life was, and so conveying the pathos of it in the music. From Connecticut, they traveled to Washington, D.C., where they sang for Ulysses S. Grant, members of the Congress, and a few Supreme Court justices. Ella wrote, "Success is now at hand. Our concerts are so well attended that many people are doomed to stand, but many more leave for want of room. In some cases, excursion trains run to the places where we sing. The people seem to be perfectly frantic about the Jubilee Singers. U.S. Grant only had one song to ask them to sing.
When Israel was in Egypt's land,
let my people go.
Oppressed so hard they could not stand.
Carried home another $20,000 with which was purchased the site of our new school. We returned to Fisk amid great rejoicing. After only 2 weeks of rest, the Jubilee Singers, now a professional ensemble with managers and assistants, set out on the road again. Now with 11 members, they went first to Boston and then they set sail for England. The first concert in London was sponsored by the Earl of Shaftesbury, a famous social reformer. It was he who introduced them to Queen Victoria. She asked them to sing Sweet Low, Sweet Chariot. The Queen neither applauded nor thanked them. Ella wrote, "The Queen wore no crown, no robes of state, but it was the Queen in flesh and blood. I saw her, I heard her deep, low voice saying, 'Tell them we were delighted with their songs.' I wondered why the Queen did not speak these words to us. We were within hearing." Victoria that night wrote in her journal, "They are real Negroes, come from America and have been slaves. They sing extremely well together." The Queen's pleasure opened every door. Prime Minister Gladstone, the Prince of Wales, dukes, duchesses, and earls were transfixed by their songs. Her approval opened doors for the Jubilee Singers in England, and they were bombarded with invitations. People who previously wouldn't have let a Black person through the front door of their homes were treating the Fisk Singers as celebrities. In the spring of 1874, the Jubilee Singers returned home in triumph with another $50,000 worth of construction of Jubilee Hall. The following year, they set out for a 3-year European tour to raise even more money for the construction of the hall. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Many of the singers will remember these concerts as the crowning triumph of their careers. The singers worked harder than ever before. In Germany alone, they sang 68 concerts in 42 towns in 68 days. Even when the audiences did not understand the words, they cried and smiled at the same places as English audiences had. At Potsdam, they sang for Kaiser Wilhelm I. As the Jubilee sang, Crown Princess Victoria, daughter of Victoria of England, burst into tears. Ella Sheppard wrote in her diary, afterwards we remarked that she hoped we did not think her silly, but she could not help weeping. She is in mourning for a child, and the song probably reminded her of her lost one. As they sang in Germany, Switzerland, Holland, and France, Jubilee Hall was finally completed. A handful of young people, most of them teenagers who had known slavery, abuse, heartache, war, hunger, and hatred, set up to save their school, and they had succeeded. During their 7 years together, the Jubilee Singers would earn the equivalent of $3 million in today's money. On the return voyage, when the Statue of Liberty came into sight, the Jubilees gathered on deck to sing together once more. First, the battle hymn of the Republic and the Star-Spangled Banner, and finally ending with John Brown's Body. In the final verse, they sang, now has come the Jubilee, when all mankind are free. Glory, glory, hallelujah, his soul is marching on. Ella eventually returned to Fisk to be the teacher that she had wanted to become when she first arrived in 1868. Ella never did graduate from Fisk University. She became a confidant of Frederick Douglass and Booker T. Washington, a mentor for hundreds of young musicians, and by the time of her death at the age of 63, one of the most respected and revered women of her day. Every year, Jubilee Singers, past and present, gather to sing at the graves of Ella and the other members of the original choir who are buried in Nashville. They sing to unite their past with the future and to keep alive the memory of their courage and resolve. For 149 years, the Jubilee Singers have traveled the world singing their good news. Good night.